I'm Steve Higgins. I'm the Director of Animal and Environmental Compliance from the University of Kentucky College of Agriculture, Food and the Environment. We're here today on the Eden Shale Farm in Owen County, Kentucky, that's controlled by the Beef Cattle Network. We're here today to look at how they've installed waters on their farm and to explore some key concepts that producers need to know. So on this particular water, this is like an 8 foot, 8 foot 6 tire water. And we've cut out the inner liner, basically the sidewall of it, and removed it. You want to keep some of that sidewall liner. The minimum is you want to keep at least 3 inches for the cow to have a lip to go over. The water level height needs to be like 2 to 4 inches below the surface height right here, so you don't have water overflowing, but you also don't have splashing. This dimension right here is critical from the ground to the top of this. What does it need to be? Well, it depends on what you're watering. If you're watering cattle, then it can be just cattle, just cows. It can be 36 inches off the ground. But if you want calves to be able to reach it, it can't be any more than 20. So that's why this one's set at 20. We got a concrete pad going out around this. This is actually an octagon shape. And this goes out 8 or 9 feet, depending on where you're measuring, from the edge of the water. And the whole point of that is we want the entire cow on this concrete to get a drink. We want it nice and flat because her job in this point is to get a drink of water, and you want it to be ergonomically efficient for her to do that. If this is being used in the wintertime, we definitely want concrete. If this is just a summertime water, you're just running stockers from May to October, and this is not going to get any wintertime use, you can probably negate the concrete. But again, it depends on what kind of soils this is going into. If it's got a high clay content, which we have, then soil and water is basically going to create mud. This water's got a drain on it, which we just used so we could drain this thing so we could work on it. But the drain, you drain this thing, you don't want it discharging like right here, because again, soil and water is going to make mud. What we do is we run this drain down to the bottom of the hill. We discharge it down into the trees, and that way we don't have a mud problem, we don't have a gully erosion problem, we're not losing our soils. This particular water source right here, this nice clean water, is actually rainwater that we're collecting off the barn that's behind us. And that roof water stored in these large tanks, we're actually collecting 12,000 gallons. And we're collecting 12,000 gallons because we need 12,000 gallons to water the animals for the period of time that we have them in this particular area, which is normally around 7 to 10 days. So you take the herd numbers, what their water consumption rate is, and then there again, water consumption rate. Normally, it's a gallon per 100 pounds is what they would normally drink. So you got a 1,500-pound cow, she's going to drink 15 gallons in a day. But if it's really hot summertime condition, it's 95 degrees, been 95 for 4 days, they'll probably drink twice that amount at 30 gallons. So you got to have the amount of water available to them. We're also running what we call a hybrid system, in that we're utilizing this rainwater that we're collecting off the roof of the barn. But we also have a valve over here where we can turn this over and switch it over to city water in an instant, which is really good. And in order to do that, what you really should have is two separate dedicated lines. One line coming to this water to serve city water, one line coming off the harvested water that goes in the tank. So you would have basically two different floats. You put the floats in this containment right here so the cattle can't reach it. You put a containment around the water so the cows can't get it and foul the water. And so those are some of the things you do. You also should have backflow preventers or air gaps to basically prevent this cow spit essentially from going back into the city water supply if the water was to, you know, you lose pressure or something like that, and you're not sucking that water back into the city water supply and distributing it to houses and whatnot. So backflow preventers and air gaps are critical. Another thing to think about is again, we're talking about waters here. And so you have some producers that go, all right, I need water out in this field so I can water cattle. Well, in this particular situation, if we back up and we show you the wide shot of this, I've got 1, 2, 3 different gates going to 3 different areas. So this one water is serving multiple areas, okay? I also have a lane or what we call a trailway, alleyway type of thing. And this is outfitted with geotextile fabric and rock. So again, we don't produce mud, but I got enough room in here to basically put in mineral diets. I can put them in portable bunkers to feed concentrated diets. We can use this as a catch pen. So this is also, putting this in the right location is also key as far as how it can be mutually beneficial to other things. One of the things we got going on with this water that's behind us is it's got a leak. It's got a faulty valve, and that's because of the plumbing pipe that we used. So when put it in a water, you can't just use, I mean, we should have used, like maybe someone said, well, you should have used galvanized pipe. But you can't use galvanized pipe in these particular soils. So that's something else you have to look at when you install one of these waters, is what kind of soils do we have as far as what kind of materials are we going to use. So instead of using galvanized pipe, we use this flexible material called copper tubing substitute, CTS. And it's flexible. And what happens is when that pipe moves, then the float basically moves with it, and so we can't get the water to shut off. So we got a constant leak. So we should have plumbed in rigid plumbing. And so this whole thing is you got to get or have good plumbing skills to install these things so that you don't have trouble with them down the road. So this is a smaller tire water. This is a 6 foot compared to the 8.5 foot that we like to use. But on the 8.5s, we usually split them between a fence. This one's, you know, just all by itself, which is great. So cattle can have access all the way around this. This water is set up as a rotational grazing hub. What we've got is a semi-compound containment area. And again, we got 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 different gates going out to 5 different pastures. So this one water serves 5 pastures and facilitates rotational grazing. Another good point about this is it's got a minimal amount of concrete around it. It's got some grooves in it for cattle traffic, which is great. But it also, you can see it's almost seamless with the rock interface that's next to it. And this would be geotextile fabric and rock. And this is exactly what you want. You want that tire or this water recessed down into the ground so the cattle are on their normal surface and then they walk onto this without stepping up or stepping down. That's how you want this, okay? Why do you want it that way? Well, if you take a 1,500 pound cow that's standing on 4 feet and then she has to step down off this concrete down to a soil surface, a grass surface, a rock surface, whatever, she's transferring all that weight onto 1 foot. Therefore, you will have a depression all the way around this concrete if it's not the same level with the gravel, which is what you want. So that's another good point about this. Again, with a large containment area like this, it facilitates rotational grazing, but we can also use this as basically a hub to hold cattle, to capture them, to treat them if we wanted to load them up on a gooseneck right there and take them out. But you can amortize out this water over 5 different pastures now, as opposed to having 1 water in each of the 5 pastures. There's also a draw down at the bottom. It's got a creek in it. They could drink out of that, but by providing this on the summit position, great location, they'll rather come up here and get this city water to drink rather than drink out of those other sources down the bottom of the hill. This area is our spring development. So what we did was we harnessed this spring by isolating it. You put in a wall, essentially an impermeable wall. You put a conduit in that, so basically you dammed up that water, and then that water overflows, goes to the conduit, and goes into this junction box. So we recess this down into the ground. The junction box has got a feeding line that goes out to that tire water that's split between those two fences. It also has an overflow that's actually a perforated pipe or corrugated pipe that actually goes down to the trees and discharges that. So if we get too much water in the spring in the junction box, more than what the tire can handle, the overflow of that goes down to the draw. In installing this, there was a couple things we wanted to do. Because what's going on in this field that's back behind me over here on this side is this is a very long field. And so what we had was we had cattle paths that were going back to the water. And there were lots of them. And they were running down the hill slopes. So there were multiple ones that ran along the contour of the slopes. We call it cow touring, which is kind of a little bit of a joke. But it's cattle paths is what it is. And those are compacted areas that aren't going to grow grass. So in order to alleviate that or try to remove that, what we did was install or develop this spring so that we can put in that water over there. Because the rule is you do not want cattle in the state of Kentucky walking over 600 feet to get to a water source. If they have to walk over 600 feet and the field's bigger than that, then they're not going to be utilizing the forages away from that water source. So you want water within that 600 feet boundary rule. So by putting in and developing this spring, we put in a tire water that's over there, and it's split between 2 different pastures. Again, we don't like to put in 1 water for 1 pastures. We have 2 ways, 3 ways, 4 ways, 5 ways. We almost put one in over there, it's a 7. But we split it between 2 pastures. Now we could probably cut down on that cow touring because now we have a water source on this end of the field for them to utilize. Over there, so the tires is sitting on geotextile fabric and rock. There's no concrete around it. We just have concrete in the basin just to make it impermeable so it holds water. It's spring fed, so it's got basically the water goes in and we have a discharge valve or pipe that basically takes the overflow, runs it down to the draw. So it's a continuous flow, and that means you also don't have to worry about it freezing in the wintertime, which is great. This tire right here, tire water, is using shade balls. So these are black balls that are filled with air, but they're also weighted. They got a liquid in them to weight them so that they sit down in the water. You can kind of see where the water line is. We use them to basically protect the surface of the water, which cuts down on algae growth, or cladophora is one of the varieties. You can put those in there and the cows just put them out of the way. They get a drink and they go on. We thought these balls would help us out on wintertime as far as not keeping the tire from freezing, but they just got away, and actually if the tire did kind of skim, freeze over a little bit, it just made it more difficult to bust the ice. But this water doesn't have any concrete around it. It's just geotextile fabric and rock. We got the containment around it to keep them out of it. We can subdivide this. The whole idea was we're gonna subdivide this pasture to allow the animals to have access to each side to facilitate rotational grazing. The water for this particular water comes from two different sources. It's a hybrid system. It could run off of city water, but we prefer to run it off of harvested water, which is rainwater that comes off the roof of the barn. So we capture that water off the roof using gutters and downspouts. That discharges into cisterns, and then we pump the water in the cistern using a solar panel and a low wattage 24 volt pump to pump into this tank that we put in the corn crib. So we're utilizing a corn crib that we weren't utilizing before. Push the tank in there, cover it with shade cloth to cut down on the heat load that would be on the water, and then we use it to basically as a water tower to gravity feed to a tire water that's on the other side for those two paddocks over there, and a gravity feed into this water right here. So one of the things we like to do here at Eden Shale is take advantage of what we call free energy, free work, and one of those would be solar energy and gravity. So those things we take advantage of because trying to make our drudgery less. And it's something for producers to think about as far as how this could line up with their whole operation to make it more efficient.